Hi, I'm Kumi Taguchi. On this episode of Insight, getting into the online sex industry is easier than ever, and there's money to be made. We look at who's selling and who's buying.
It's like the new Uber. You can go on, you can register, and you can go out and make some money.
I was working out in the elements, manual labour job. Now I get to work with my beautiful wife every day.
And you make porn.
And we make porn.
Do you agree that it's easy money?
Emotionally, I would say that it's not easy.
I used it when the brothels were closed in lockdown, but I really hated it. I was filming in my own bedroom, it was in my own house. It was bringing my work into my personal space.
I actually don't want it to be a career. I always want it to be a side hustle, and it will always be a side hustle to me.
I am really proud owning my own business. I've been a beautician for 5 years now. I started when I was 18, so fresh out of high school. I do all eyelash related treatments. So you've got your lash extensions, your natural side, so your lash lifts, lash tints. I actually feel like I'm quite popular for my brow bar. I'm Priscilla Martin, and my day job is a beauty entrepreneur. And my after 5 p.m. job, I am known as Brunette Barbie on OnlyFans.
Looks good, everything looks ready to go. Let's do it.
I think in the first 24 hours I earned over 5k, and that was with 240 subscribers. OnlyFans is an online platform that you can be a content creator and post your own content, or be a consumer and I guess view that person's content.
Anything I guess front here or here is what I would classify as PG for my timeline. Mm-hmm. Anything like just side profile, even just like a little bit is paid.
Stuff that I do like publicly shown, I keep it quite PG, a little bit raunchy. And then obviously all the stuff that you pay for would obviously be your XX type of content.
Today guys, we are going to create a lolly shake that we can all enjoy together.
I love attention, I won't lie, I do love attention, hence why I guess I do content creating. But a bit too much attention is a bit crazy. So yeah, there are stalkers, there are all of that. And I think with any social media, you've got to be prepared for that.
Mmm, yummy.
I don't like having the stigma of being an OnlyFans girl, I will say. Everyone obviously has their own point of view, but their opinions aren't going to pay my bills. So unfortunately, I'm still here to hustle.
Beautiful.
I don't think there is any other legal way to make the money that we are making.
Priscilla, you say you don't like the stigma of being an OnlyFans girl. What do you mean by that?
I'd say probably they think I do it for easy money, I'd say. A lot of people say that OnlyFans is easy money, and that is not the case at all either.
You're 23. You started your account when you were 19.
Yeah.
Why?
I never wanted to be an OnlyFans girl. I did say I was never going to be an OnlyFans girl. And then pre-COVID, I remember I put a post on my Instagram, a poll, to see what my followers wanted. And they actually ticked yes, so it was too good to be true, and I'd never went back.
Had you posted racy photos online before?
Yes, so I actually was posting pretty raunchy, cheeky stuff on my Instagram, and I thought I could be getting paid for this.
Did you think this was something you would do as a career?
Definitely not, and I actually don't want it to be a career. I always want it to be a side hustle, and it will always be a side hustle to me, and that's how I view it as.
Did you ever think there was an age where you would stop?
Yes, 21.
What other plans did you have?
I actually started studying law before I actually did OnlyFans. At this time, I was still having my beauty business. And then, obviously, I actually wanted to work full-time, so I kind of canned the law, and I remember one of my girlfriends actually telling me, you know, how are you ever going to do law when you literally do sex work? And I said, that is the reason I'm going to do law, because the stigma.
Why didn't you stop at 21?
It was too good to stop.
The money?
Yeah. The money, the atmosphere, the people I've met through OnlyFans as well, the gorgeous girls that I've met and become friends with. It's just like a really good connecting atmosphere to be a part of.
Content subscription sites have boomed in member numbers. They've also boomed in terms of how much revenue can be made since the pandemic. Here's how they work.
All kinds of content is bought and sold by users over 18 years of age, from fitness routines to music lessons. By far, the most popular category is pornography, from lingerie and bikini photos to explicit videos and fetish content. Content creators make money by sharing their material with paying subscribers. They charge extra for custom content, including chatting and sexting with their followers. The biggest platform in this space is OnlyFans, which launched in 2016. The website boasts more than 220 million subscribers and 3 million creators, stating it's creating economic opportunity for ordinary people. The top 1% of accounts earn a third of all money spent, while the average creator is estimated to earn less than $300 a month. OnlyFans takes a 20% cut of all earnings.
Tom and Evelyn, you're married. You have an OnlyFans account together.
Yes.
How much money do you guys make?
A lot. We've bought multiple houses. We've set ourselves up forever, just doing it in a couple of years.
Tom, until a few years ago, you'd been working as an electrician.
Yep, high voltage electrician, yeah.
How would you describe your job now?
It's amazing. I was working out in the elements, manual labour job, and now I get to work with my beautiful wife every day.
And you make porn.
And we make porn.
What prompted the career change?
We were kind of a little bit done. We had a life set up in Adelaide and we were getting a little bit sick of the climate. We moved up to Queensland and we thought, what should we do now? We didn't really have anything in place. We were actually going to start a little takeaway cafe shop, and then COVID happened, so we kind of fell into this.
Where did you first hear about OnlyFans?
Evelyn's friends. She had a couple of friends who were making maybe $5,000 a month, and they said, try it out, see what happens. And this is the sort of content that we post, and this is what you can potentially make. So we thought, give it a go, see how we go.
Did you have any experience in sex work when you got into this?
Nothing at all, no.
Evelyn, you're Tom's wife. Do you agree with him that what you post on OnlyFans is pornography?
Yes, definitely.
What kind of content do you make?
We make all sorts of content, mainly boy-girl content, which is quite rare. I think on OnlyFans, a lot of it's like solo or girl stuff.
Yep.
A lot of our stuff is boy-girl.
So subscribers prefer that boy-girl content, your subscribers at least?
I've definitely found subscribers like that, yeah.
Had you done sex work before?
Yeah, years ago I worked as an escort, in-person sex work.
And what was your reaction when Tom came to you and said, hey, let's start an OnlyFans account?
I was just like, no, because I was so private. I had to be so private in in-person sex work, and this required me to be so out there in marketing and social media and things like that.
How do you think sites like OnlyFans compare with more, say, traditional porn websites?
Personally, I prefer OnlyFans, but again, that's because we're making so much money. I think if you weren't earning as much, the effort that you put in, it wouldn't be worth it. We own everything, we get to choose what we put out there. And again, though, like in-person sex work is very similar, you can still have all the same decisions, but I found it much more like emotionally taxing.
What would the main difference be between OnlyFans from the in-person work that you were doing before?
I think OnlyFans, I mainly work with people who I choose to work with, and in-person work, you don't get to choose your clients. You sort of have to just adapt to the situation, and some of those are really uncomfortable.
Tilly, you've been a sex worker for 10 years.
Yeah.
You've worked in brothels, massage parlours, and as an escort. Have you used OnlyFans?
Yeah, I used it when the brothels were closed in lockdown in 2020. And I did make good money off it. Like, I already had a following, so I got to the top 2% in, like, the first few weeks, but I really hated it.
What didn't you like about it?
For me, there's a disconnect. I'm on my computer enough in a day anyway, and I'm on my phone enough. And I think also the isolation of lockdown heightened the fact that these people that you're interacting with are faceless. You know, one of the things I like about in-person sex work is, as Evelyn said, it can be super exhausting, but I often find there's something like life-affirming about meeting all different kinds of people and having nice interactions with someone I wouldn't meet under any other circumstances. And also I think there's like, for me, there's a delineation between the sex I have in my private life and the sex I have at work. And with OnlyFans, that was kind of taken away because I was doing like a lot of solo scenes, like I was masturbating. I got so sick of masturbating. I didn't masturbate for 6 months after I quit OnlyFans. I was like, I'm done. And also like, you know, I was filming in my own bedroom, was in my own house. It was bringing my work into my personal space. I mean, it's odd because I think people think of sex as the most personal thing, but I think my home is the most personal thing for me. So having people in my home wasn't a vibe.
Do you think the normalisation of OnlyFans helps to destigmatise sex work?
No, I think we're seeing like a hyper visibility of like a certain kind of sex work at the moment, which is like online sex work. And you could argue that the media attention around OnlyFans is destigmatizing OnlyFans isn't helping to destigmatize other kinds of sex work. I think because OnlyFans is so anti like in-person sex work, like they will delete your account and hold back your earnings if they find out that you're also doing in-person sex work. So you will hear a lot of like online sex workers say, oh, well, I'm not a prostitute. Oh, I don't meet up with people. I don't do this. So unfortunately, there's a lot of throwing under the bus by online sex workers of other sex workers. So like, I don't think you can say that the conversation around OnlyFans is moving forward the conversation around sex worker rights, for example. Mm-hmm. Like, it's still illegal to do in-person sex work in South Australia. None of the coverage around OnlyFans is moving that forward.
Evelyn, what do you think has social media made online sex work more acceptable?
Maybe not more acceptable because there is still massive stigma. We don't experience it as much because we're married, which is really interesting. Mm-hmm. I feel like when I was single and when I was an escort, I copped it really harshly. I don't know so much that it is completely reducing stigma.
Tegan, you've done a PhD on the sex industry in Victoria. Who's selling sexually explicit content on sites like OnlyFans?
It's mostly women and they're creating content for a mostly male audience. We've seen, I guess, the rise in the beginning of the pandemic. We saw brothels shut or in-person sex work kind of stop during some of the lockdowns. And so women were in this, position where they often were out of work and were less likely to get government support. So there was kind of, the environment was there. And at the same time, we saw a massive rise in demand for online sexual content. So pornography boomed during lockdown. And so it was kind of a perfect storm for women to turn to OnlyFans, I think. And there was a kind of positive representation of OnlyFans as this quick, easy way to make money. Mm.
Dane, you subscribed to adult content through the online paid platform called Patreon, which is similar to OnlyFans. Who did you follow?
I followed one person in particular. I was a heavy user of pornography in general, and some had started to put content on their subscriber sites. And what I was thinking at the time was that there was a lot of this pornography out there that was free, but some people were trying to make a living out of this too. Looking back, I had a problem with overuse, but at the time, I think I was trying to set limits around it too and maybe give it some shape, some balance, and that was an element of it as well. And paying for it and recognising someone for their work seemed like a step towards better ethics.
Did you feel a personal connection to that content creator?
Somewhat, yes. It's someone I'd followed for years. I'd seen a lot of their material without paying anything too, and over time that didn't feel right. I think there was the option to talk to them directly, but they were foreign language, so I didn't take that up, but I could have. Mm.
Eden, you started an OnlyFans account after starring on a reality TV show called Love Island. Why?
I think multitude of reasons. COVID had happened. I was in Bali and the world was shutting down, and also got the call that my job was gone. I had a lot of friends on OnlyFans and my Instagram was already bikini photos and lingerie, and I'd been modelling for so long, and I thought, well, I've got this huge audience here. Why don't I try and make some money out of it, really?
Has it been a full-time job since then?
Yeah, pretty much since day one that I started, it's been full-time since 2020.
Do you think that appearing, say, on a reality TV show is a path to a career on OnlyFans?
I think it can be if you want it to be. I think, you know, you're kind of lying if you're going onto a reality TV show just for love. You know you're going to get a following out of it. So whether it's you want to jump into being an influencer or start a brand or promote teeth whitening products, you can monetize that audience. So I think a lot of people would jump on there and go, I'm going to launch OnlyFans and it's going to be so easy for me.
Instagram has some pretty strict rules around nudity. Has the nature of what you share now become more explicit?
Yeah, absolutely. I used to post kind of like at the beach nude and stuff on my Instagram. I didn't really see a problem with my own body, but Instagram does. And I just thought, well, I can be creative and take the photos that I want and enjoy taking. And if that is nude, then yeah, I can put that on OnlyFans.
You're one of the top earners on OnlyFans. Is it hard work?
I can't turn around and say that it's hard. I mean, it definitely can be a hustle. I think I'm very grateful that I had a following. So I already had the people, the subscribers there ready to go. But if you don't have that, I feel like it would be a hustle. I feel like it's a marketing job. You're every single day marketing yourself to find an audience.
When you look at other kinds of jobs out there, how do you compare it?
My best friend is a lawyer and she studied a crazy degree and she works so hard Monday to Friday in these crazy hours. And I look at what I make compared to what she makes and I can get 10 times the money a lot easier.
Mm. Georgia, you also post on OnlyFans. Do you agree that it's easy money?
I think it kind of depends on the context of what you describe as easy. In terms of what Eden was saying about other industries and the amount of work that they put in, yes, it's definitely easy money. I don't have to work as many hours and the type of content that I get to make is definitely on my terms. But emotionally, I would say that it's not easy. Like for your mental health, it definitely requires a lot of work. You have to get really comfortable with yourself. And being on a platform like OnlyFans, you are going to be copying stigma. You're going to be copying abuse from people. You're going to be having content leaked, things like that. There's definitely a lot of negatives to that. So when people say, oh, it's just easy money, yes, in terms of the hours that I work compared to a normal 9-to-5 job, it is, but emotionally, it's a lot of hard work.
Do you mind me asking how much you made, say, in the first few months of being on OnlyFans?
I was really fortunate. I already had quite a large social media following. So the first month I made $25,000. And then I think within the first 6 months I was close to $100,000.
Your modelling agency actually suggested that you start an account.
Yes.
How did you feel about that idea when they proposed it to you?
It was a mixture of like my modelling work and then also I was approached by an OnlyFans management company as well. So it was a combination of the two. And I was sceptical at first because I was 21 and single and I was worried about how it might affect my romantic relationships in the future. And I was also worried about, you know, just I think what everyone's worried about, how it's going to affect your image online. Mm. I had just finished studying an opera degree and I was fully like considering doing that path as a career. But I just saw how much money people were making and I was broke. I was a receptionist working at a job that I hated. I had just started a new relationship and he lived in a different city to me and I couldn't even afford to get a new car. And I just thought OnlyFans was such an incredible opportunity and I was talking to my mum about it because she's also quite pro-sex work. And she basically said to me, this is not going to be around forever. It's totally your decision at the end of the day, but you may as well jump in and just see how it goes. And I did. I just decided to start posting what I was already getting banned on Instagram for posting on my OnlyFans. Mm-hmm. So for me, it just started out as artistic nude modelling on my OnlyFans.
There's so much free porn available on the internet. Why do you think people pay to subscribe to content like yours?
I definitely think it's not so much about the porn or the content, it's about the person that they're subscribing to. I mean, anyone can go onto Pornhub, so it's the combination of that custom content and it's coming from you as an individual.
Mm. Taylor, you were working full-time in retail when you started your OnlyFans account. How long did it take you to start earning more from OnlyFans than you were from your retail job?
Once I became public with OnlyFans, it took about 4 weeks for OnlyFans to take over my salary. And I found myself at work sort of wanting to step outside of my store and message people back and jump on the hustle and make that bit of extra money. And I just couldn't stand working full time anymore, knowing that I had that sitting there on my phone that I could jump on and make my whole day's work in sometimes 10 minutes.
What kind of content do you post on your account?
I post everything I do, solo content, I make content with my boyfriend, and what we've been going into lately is live streams, which has been probably one of the biggest earners on my account since I've started it, is going live.
Do you do customised videos for your subscribers?
Yeah, I do. I'm pretty open to most requests. Yeah, lots of custom content.
Has there been something that someone's requested that you didn't want to do?
Only one. It was quite early on when I made my account. It was a screenshot from this subscriber's notes page on their phone. It was 8 screenshots long and it was a mother and son fetish. And at first, I was like, you know what, I'll give it a go. Let's see if I can step into this role. So he had paid for it. And then I sat on it for a couple of weeks and I was like, I can't keep this person waiting. This is getting ridiculous. Obviously, I'm not comfortable doing it. So I actually paid him his money back. And this was probably 6 months ago. He subscribed again about 2 weeks ago now and he thanked me again for paying him back. And he said, I want to buy some content because you were just so nice all of those months ago and came back. I had had this subscriber almost since the beginning and it said from your contacts. And my heart just sank into my stomach and I was like, I know who this person is.
Do you talk about death?
Nah, it's not something that I'd talk about.
I'm not afraid of death, I just don't want to be there when it happens.
You're 26. Why have you recorded your own eulogy?
It's more of a celebration of life, not the acceptance of defeat.
There'll be French champagne. I don't want Yellow Glen. I want quality. I'm paying for it. You can have it, you can enjoy it.
I started my nursing career when the pandemic really hit Australia. I am in my mid-20s and I have been a registered nurse for 3 years. I started an OnlyFans account around the time when I actually first started nursing. Around early March, nurses received an email in regards to OnlyFans from the Nursing and Midwifery Council, basically saying that they didn't like that nurses were engaging in that type of work. The Nursing and Midwifery Board may consider social media use in your private life, even where there is no identifiable link to you as a registered health practitioner, if it raises concerns about your fitness to hold a registration. When I saw that email, it was honestly very upsetting to see that something like an OnlyFans account could potentially derail your career. With the nursing world, everyone's burnt out, everyone's stressed out. We have the wage cap, lots of nurses feel unsupported. OnlyFans just gives me more money that I can do whatever I want with. So if someone at work found out about my OnlyFans account, I could probably lose my job. I could lose reputation, which is really a sad thing to think about. When I post, I don't show my face. I don't show any noticeable markings or tattoos on my body. I am definitely very private about these things. I don't think I would make a career on OnlyFans. I'm so focused on what I want to do with my future in nursing. In my opinion, the Nursing and Midwifery Council of New South Wales sending that email, I don't think it will necessarily change a lot of things. For some people, the only option that they have is to actually sell their bodies and to sell explicit content to actually make a living. I'm not hurting anyone.
The Nursing and Midwifery Council of New South Wales says it aims to reinforce professional standards, including how inappropriate conduct on social media can lead to complaints of professional misconduct. Annie, you started your OnlyFans account in 2020 while you were working in marketing. Did you think it might jeopardise your day job?
Yes, that was definitely my number one concern when I first started my account. And the last thing I wanted to do was to get fired if someone found my OnlyFans.
Did those fears eventuate?
Yes. A few years later, they did. Yeah, and I got fired from one of my jobs.
What happened there?
I had just started a new job. I was on day five and I actually went home sick that day. And I received an email saying termination of contract. Now, I was shocked. I didn't know what was going on. And I read the email and quickly saw screenshots of my OnlyFans on the email and a list of three reasons why I was fired, basically.
What reasons did they give for your dismissal?
They said that I falsely advised that I had a side business. They said that I didn't ask permission from the company to run a side business. And they said that I had online pornographic images of myself and crude language. And apparently that was against company rules.
Did you just accept that ruling?
I did, only because by day five, I hated the job so much that I wasn't going to fight the ruling. Mm. But I was definitely very upset and very angry at the decision.
Gary, you advise employees about unfair dismissal, sexual harassment and also workplace discrimination. What do you make of Annie's experience?
Well, it is a stretch. Are companies taking a legal view, or are they really the owner taking a moral view? It's in this new era of what we have with respect at work, where companies have to take positive steps towards eradicating sexual harassment in the workplace. Now, companies have already got policies, already got training. What else can they do? So female's got an OnlyFans account. Maybe the company doesn't so much care about that. But what they do care about is now males going to join that female employee's OnlyFans account. Are they going to pass it around the workplace? Will this lead into a complaint from that female? Mm. And it's easier to be proactive, terminate the female, so we don't get that to that point and we don't get that problem.
So workplaces might be inclined to fire someone who has that OnlyFans account in order to prevent sexual harassment from a colleague.
Correct. There's a positive duty under the Respect at Work Act.
Have you had cases where someone has been dismissed for having an OnlyFans account?
We have. It's starting to flow through, but what companies are doing is wanting to get rid of people very early so they don't get access to the unfair dismissal laws.
Mm. The New South Wales Council of Nursing and Midwifery has warned nurses about posting on OnlyFans. Mm. Do you think that's fair?
Well, no, I don't. What you do in your own time, the argument is it's your own business. But what perhaps the board is considering, as you're a health professional, is you've got to maintain the trust and confidence of your employer. You're a nurse, you're a responsible position, and maybe you're bringing that into disrepute. That would be their argument, but both can coexist. What you do after hours, it should be fair. The way I put it to people, it's like the new Uber. You can go on, you can register, and you can go out and make some money. Well, it's lawful, that's where it should be.
Amy, you're 21. You started your OnlyFans account 6 months ago.
Yeah.
Why?
So I was actually working 4 to 5 days a week at a retail job. I didn't love it, but I didn't hate it either. And I'm also doing full-time uni, so I was struggling balancing both. I live out of home, so it was living paycheck to paycheck, and I thought this could just earn me a couple extra $100 a week, and then quickly it turned into way more than that.
When did this become a job as opposed to a side hustle?
Yeah, so my first 24 hours to 48 hours of my account, I made more than I did in a month at my retail job. And I thought that I could be making way more money by pursuing it rather than going and working 4 or 5 days a week when I could be marketing or creating more content, things like that. So, yeah, that's when I quit my job a month in.
What were your career plans before that?
Yes, I'm studying a Bachelor of Medical Science, majoring in anatomy and physiology, and my career goals were always to finish this degree and get into medicine.
So is that still your goal or is it on hold at the moment?
I'm still going to finish my degree and apply for medicine, but I also want to pursue OnlyFans for as long as I can. So it's kind of my backup option now.
Do you think there might be any other things you won't be able to do in future now because of the online sex work?
I hope that by the time I finish my degree and maybe go on and do another one, things have changed and it's normalised a little bit more because there's so many girls on there and males as well that it's going to be normalised later on because so many people have done it. It's kind of hard to discriminate against them now.
Priscilla, you were studying law before your OnlyFans took off. Do you still feel the same way about the law?
I definitely do, and I feel like now that OnlyFans has definitely gotten popular, it's a need for, I guess, a legal system to be, I guess, made for that, and that's a heavy reason why I would definitely go back into it.
Georgia, what sort of content do you share?
It started off with just artistic nude content because I was doing a lot of artistic nude modelling beforehand, and then COVID happened. And my partner and I had actually decided to make more pornographic content together. Just because we owned gyms at that point and all the gyms had shut down during COVID, we went, okay, well, we need to kind of increase our income a bit here. So we then made boy-girl content for 6 months or so.
Did making content with your partner affect your relationship?
Yeah, it did. It kind of made our sex life become work. And we weren't really having sex because we wanted to have sex. We were like, oh, we need to film more content. So it kind of became a bit of a chore. And so it was definitely affecting our sex life in a negative way. And mentally, I know that my partner was just not really wanting to do that because he had other career and business goals and he's a very driven person. So it was definitely affecting his mental health, but also mine as well, because I realized that the money that we were making wasn't really worth it because I was crossing boundaries that I had in place for myself to make more money. And I was just kind of feeling really like bad about myself afterwards because I knew it wasn't what I wanted to be known for.
What boundaries have you now established around what you are and what you aren't willing to do online?
My current boundaries mainly is I just don't show below the waist. I don't film any sort of boy-girl content anymore. I'll do collabs with other women, you know, making out with other women and things like that. And I'll make more sexual content, like masturbation kind of videos, but usually I'm wearing underwear, so it's just over the top.
How does your partner feel about being on OnlyFans now?
He would definitely never come back to doing it. And he definitely, I wouldn't say he regrets doing it because it definitely served a purpose. And we learned a lot as a couple about us and our boundaries. But he's definitely not the biggest fan of doing it for himself, but he is a big supporter of me doing it as long as it makes me happy.
Was there a point where you felt pressure that you should be doing more?
There was definitely a massive increase in income when we started doing the more sexual content. And I think I felt pressured by the subscribers a little bit because I was obviously attracting more subscribers who were into the more sexual content because that was what I was, again, advertising. So I was always getting asked, you know, come on, show like my vagina and things like that, and getting pressured and then getting abused a little bit by subscribers when I said that I didn't do that.
Priscilla, how about you? Have you felt pressure?
There are times where I feel like I am pressured to push boundaries, but there are also times where I actually don't have any boundaries, that sometimes when they push me, then I create them. So, yeah, if they weren't pushing me, I would have no boundaries to create, so.
Have you ever had your content copied and shared elsewhere?
Yes, I have.
What happened with that?
So it was all posted over social media. It was a video had been, like, taken a screenshot of, and that was all that was posted on social media. So it was actually manipulated, and obviously not the full story was there.
Georgia, has your content ever been copied and leaked?
Hundreds of times. I actually had it posted on Pornhub at one point and had to get a legal team involved for that. But the biggest one was someone sent it to my mum. So this was back when my partner and I were doing more of the sexual content, and they fully screen recorded the whole thing, sent it to my mum and basically said, are you proud of your whore daughter? Luckily, my mum and I are very close and she's very supportive and she's always been a big advocate for sex work. So now I pay an external company to basically monitor and take down any leaked content that they see.
Tegan, you've studied how the media reports on OnlyFans. What's the coverage generally like? What's the tone?
I would say it's overwhelmingly positive. The reporting of specifically OnlyFans in Australian media, you see the stories about women earning thousands of dollars a day. It's seen as a kind of quick and easy, yes, cheeky side hustle.
What are some of the harms that can exist?
I think there are a range of harms, from like the kind of content leaking, the personal impacts on self-esteem, and there's also concerns around coercion and exploitation. So when we're seeing, you know, so many young women, it's primarily young women, going to turn to OnlyFans for financial pressure, and whether if that's, you know, a choice between paying rent and eating or not, is that really a choice? It's women being sexually objectified for men, and men really hold the power in this setup because they're the ones that are paying and can kind of choose to pay or stop payments whether their demands are met or not. Mm. So what is this doing when we're thinking about gender equality more broadly? And I also think there are questions around kind of the sex industry as an economic safety net for primarily women, and whether the state has more of a role to play there.
Tilly, do you feel like sex work exploits women?
I think women are exploited by society generally and sexualized. I think the sex industry, I think especially in-person sex work, it's an industry that a lot of women enter who don't have more traditional roots to financial stability. So you get a lot of migrant women. You wouldn't know it looking at this room because we're mainly white, but in the sex industry, you get a lot of migrant women, you get a lot of women of colour, you get a lot of queer women, you get a lot of trans women. You're basically getting people who are disenfranchised from usual workplaces. And sometimes The only thing that someone has left to work with is their body. I think the nature of work itself can be exploitative. You know, across any industry. I think it's really complicated. I think also when women are choosing to profit off their sexuality, when women are constantly sexualized anyway, it's like, who are we to turn around and say, no, you can't do that? I know for me personally, like sex work got me out of poverty, you know, and I know for a lot of women that's the same.
Taylor, you found out something pretty shocking about the identity of one of your subscribers. What happened?
I did. So about 2 months into me having my OnlyFans account, I had had this subscriber almost since the beginning. He had spent around 2,000 Australian dollars, bought every single thing that I sent him. We chatted every day on there. And he had a very specific username that was not a like automatically generated one or anything like that. And an account with the same username had viewed my TikTok profile when I could see who was viewing it at the time. So I had the exact same username and it said, from your contacts. And my heart just sank into my stomach and I was like, I don't have that many phone numbers in my phone. I know who this person is and he has spent this much money on my account, seen everything. And I just sort of went into super detective mode and I said, I need to find out who this is. I went through all of the contacts in my phone. I crossed out anybody who had a established TikTok account and crossed out the people that said invite to TikTok. And I was left with six names. It was a couple of guys from school, one girl from school, someone's mum and my stepdad. And I had just thought, okay, it could be those guys, but I feel like they would have told me, like they always message me happy birthday. It's not going to be them. It's not going to be my girlfriend. It's not going to be this mother. It has to be my stepdad.
Wow.
So I went out on a limb and messaged the account on OnlyFans and I said, I know who this is. And he responded saying, who? ?Babe, you don't know. And I then hit back pretty quickly and I said, you need to tell her before my sister and I do. And
with her being your mum?
Yeah, being my mum. And within 2 minutes, I got a text message from my stepdad saying, Tay, you're free to talk.
Wow. So yeah, it was him.
It was him.
How did you feel when you realised your stepdad was your top subscriber?
I think I went into a complete state of shock and I probably was that way for about a week, I think. Mm. I had messaged my younger sister who was living in the house with him. I still live there at the time, but just spent a lot of time at my boyfriend's house. I messaged her and I said, he is subscribed to my account and he spent this much money. And everybody was kind of in disbelief. And my sister said, we need to tell mum. So I had a group FaceTime call with both of my sisters and my mum. There was four of us sitting there. I told her and she just went completely silent, which is very rare for my mum. And he kept messaging saying, please talk to me before you talk to your mum. I'm on the way home. Like, just let me deal with her. I think he kind of wanted to sweep it under the rug. I was already on the phone with my sisters and my mum while this was all happening. And my mum just said so calmly, she said, okay, he wants to speak to you and I want to hear the whole conversation. So I ended up calling him from a private number and my mum listened to the whole thing while I was still in shock.
Wow.
Yeah.
What did your mum do after she heard that conversation?
When this all happened, he was on the way home from work and as soon as he walked in the door, I think mum sort of gave him a bit of a mouthful and he packed his bags and left that day.
How long had they been together?
12 years.
12 years.
Yeah.
Do you mind me asking what kind of content your stepdad had been requesting of you?
Yeah, so he had bought boy-girl content with my partner, but he specifically requested things like photos of my underwear every single day because I was still working full-time at the time. I had just dropped down to a casual role at my retail job. So he was requesting to see what underwear I was wearing every day, little videos. And when I was staying back at home with him and my mum, he was asking for me to film in particular rooms of the house, saying, don't film in the bathroom. I like it better when you're on your bed or on the carpet. And he was working from home a lot of the time when I wasn't there. Wow. After this had been filmed.
Did this affect your relationship with your mum and your family?
Yes. For the first couple of weeks, he was very much so the bad guy, but he sort of then went silent on everybody or people went silent on him. Both of my sisters work full-time, so she didn't really have anybody around to take it out on because he wasn't there, and she very quickly turned on me, and it all became my fault. It became OnlyFans' fault. I was enemy number one to my family for a few months.
That must have been hard.
Yeah.
How are things now?
A lot better. My mum has since moved on. I feel like we've all sort of started to rebuild our relationships a little bit. He's completely out of the picture and nobody hears from him. Nobody knows where he is.
How do you feel about it all now?
I feel okay. I still am a little bit nervous as to how I would be if I ever saw him in public, but I feel okay. I just feel very grateful that I've been able to rebuild that relationship with my mum and my sisters mostly.
Tilly, is being an OnlyFans creator safer than being a sex worker who sees clients in person?
Safety can mean different things. So if you're talking about, for example, the danger that comes when a woman meets up with any strange man alone, like, that's obviously more of an issue with in-person sex work. It's also an issue with dating as well. But if you're talking about something like privacy, which is also like a huge aspect of safety, like we've just heard about people having like their videos leaked. Working in a brothel, women can do that for many years without other people in their life knowing about it. Because you can show up to work, you're under alias, no one sees your face except for the clients. So there is a degree of privacy that happens there that doesn't happen on a website where you have to sign up with an ID. And there have been websites that have had their database of IDs leaked. Mm-hmm. That's happened in the past, could happen again. I think another aspect that, I'm sorry, I've forgotten your name.
Taylor.
That Taylor's story just really illuminated is you don't really know who your clients are, which is something very different with in-person sex work. Like at the brothel, you're seeing a little video of the client. You see if he looks familiar to you before you go in and have a look. You might peek behind the curtains first. You can refuse to see, you can refuse to even intro someone if you think there might be someone that you know. And, you know, there's girls who refuse to intro whole suburbs of people, you know. And you can, of course, refuse to have a booking with them. But when it's online and there's all these people purchasing your content, especially if you have like hundreds of subscribers, you don't really know who's viewing your content. You don't know who's viewing it, if it's being stolen and taken to other people. So I think they are huge aspects of safety.
Has this work affected your marriage?
Yeah, definitely.
We have to be on good terms to make our money. So,
and he has to be aroused.
Dane, until 2020, you'd been subscribing to online porn for many years. How often were you watching?
Towards the end of that period, quite often. It would be every day. It was something that I guess I used to deal with stress at work, perhaps, and perhaps a bit of disconnection in my personal life. I saw a lot of people in a day, but wasn't really close to many of them. And there was perhaps an hour or two in the evening I could sort of let, when I was on my own, I could let my hair down and do my own thing, so to speak. And I'd say I lost control of it, really. And I think this was quite late in my issue. And what I noticed was once I went to $5, I went to $20 and $100 almost straight away.
How easy was it to do that?
Very easy. This was all happening on a smartphone. It's very easy to spend a lot of money very quickly. I think I'd even got to the point where the pa-ping sound from the iPhone sort of almost gave me a rush on its own in anticipation of something. So, yeah, I think it was, you know, not long after that I had to admit I had a problem.
What prompted you to stop subscribing?
I kind of had a midlife crisis. My relationship broke down. I left home and I had to admit that this thing had encroached on the other areas of my life to the point where it became unmanageable.
Would you say you were addicted?
I would now. I didn't then. Like a lot of scientists and so on, I thought sex addiction was rubbish, an excuse people made to excuse their bad behaviour. And I think I probably, while I wasn't admitting to it to myself, that's probably what I thought about myself. I thought that I was just making bad decisions and there was nothing really wrong. And therefore, there was no way to get help. It wasn't until I made a decision to stop, to go cold turkey on the smartphone entirely, actually. I went and used a dumb phone and downgraded that I experienced something resembling withdrawal. And I thought, hang on a minute.
You're a member of a recovery group. What does that involve?
It turns out there's recovery groups like AA for a variety of addictions. I now do service for one of these groups. I sometimes greet new members, and there's a lot of people coming in with pornography or related addictions.
Has it helped you?
It has. Recognising that these things can be addictive. If I try to, you know, set a limit on how much I was going to pay and then blew right past it, I will find myself doing things like some of the people have said tonight. I was pushing the boundaries on what I was consuming, just as the creator's pushing the boundaries on what they're creating. So I think it's got a lot of hallmarks of addiction. And once I saw that and then picked up the tools of recovery for addiction, I found that's been more successful than anything.
Annie, you recently started an OnlyFans management agency. Why did you do that?
Well, there's hundreds of thousands of OnlyFans management agencies out there. One thing about these agencies is they're predominantly run by men. And a lot of the agencies are asking for a 50 to 80% cut of your earnings when you sign with them. So after I myself was looking for an agency, I found this was a huge issue within the industry. There was not enough management agencies owned by women, and I wanted women in the industry to have a safe, reliable and trustworthy agency that they can sign with.
What does your agency do?
So we offer a range of services. We have our weekly management plans, which range from scheduling only, where we schedule all their content for them, messaging only, which is responding to messages for our clients, and then the full service management package, which is doing everything except creating the content for them.
So a subscriber, for example, might think they're chatting or messaging a content creator, but someone from the agency is actually replying on their behalf?
Yes, correct.
Amy, your dream was to become a doctor, but you've chosen to pursue OnlyFans instead. Do you have any regrets?
I would say my only regret is not starting it sooner. Obviously, I didn't know about OnlyFans until a few months before I started, but I wish I started earlier just because it is such an oversaturated like website and industry now. People think it's easy money, so everyone jumps on. I kind of wish I started earlier where there wasn't as much competition in a way.
Do you feel like the career path is sustainable for you?
I don't think that OnlyFans is going to be around forever, but I do think that online sex work and sex work in general, there is always a place in the world for sex work, whether it's OnlyFans, whether it's another platform, or whether it's something completely different. However, I do think that I'm saving all my money and investing it into different things, hoping to start my own business one day and things like that, while still finishing all my degrees in case something completely goes wrong.
Taylor, you found out your stepfather was your top OnlyFans subscriber and was requesting specific content. Did you ever consider closing your account after that happened?
I definitely had moments where I just wanted to crawl into a hole and never touch the website again. For a couple of days after, I think I wasn't replying to people. I just couldn't stand looking at it. I was definitely very scarred, and I still to this day haven't read through all the messages with him. But I think that OnlyFans has allowed me to be a lot more comfortable within myself, and it's made my life 100 times better, and I wouldn't stop just because of that.
Yeah, so you're still creating and posting content.
Yeah.
Georgia, you've been content creating for 3 years. Is the money still as good as when you started?
I think my effort isn't as good as when I started, so therefore the money isn't as high as it was when I first started. You know, as I am getting older and having other priorities come up in my life, you know, I'm getting married soon and going to have a family soon. So it's definitely not as much money as it was when I first started, but it's still so much more than I would ever make at any other job. I do think what everyone was saying, that the market is very oversaturated, does play a huge role. You know, I used to charge a lot more for content when I first joined in 2019 versus what I can charge now, just because there are so many creators. But I think I will always be making more money doing this than I would anything else, because I am fortunate enough to have a large social media platform. Because my TikToks do go viral, it does generate me more subscribers than the average person who does OnlyFans. So I am very fortunate in the way that I run things.
Tom and Evelyn, have you found it difficult to keep subscribers with so many other creators joining OnlyFans?
Not really. We're pretty lucky to have like quite a niche market. We can film things that other people can't.
What's the niche market that you have?
I was born with two vaginas, so I have two reproductive systems. So I think people just want to see it. We can film a lot of things that normal women can't.
So you have a unique feature, and that's made it lucrative.
It has, yeah.
Would it be tough without that niche market, do you think?
It'd be a lot harder, yeah. It's really easy for us to get subscribers because it's just so rare.
Has this work affected your marriage? I'll ask you first.
Yeah, definitely. Like, when you have a fight, you don't want to have sex off camera. That's my heart. Definitely.
Tom?
Yeah, conflict resolution between us, from what I can compare to my previous relationships. If I've had a fight with somebody, like, you can just play hardball for a few days. Like, I don't want to talk to you. We have to be on good terms to make our money. For men to perform, we have to be aroused. Women can fake it.
Yeah. Mm.
And so if we're in a bad headspace or in a bad place in our relationship and I do not want to have sex with her, then we're not going to make our money. So I think it has its pros and cons on our relationship, but I think the question that you might have presented to, maybe with the intimacy, that's definitely taken a hit. If we go to get intimate, we're like, should we capitalise off of this? So each time we have to make time, we have to put time aside to go, we have to be intimate with each other and enjoy each other.
And there's no cameras?
Without cameras, yeah.
What about relationships with other family? Has your work affected those?
Yeah, for sure. My mum, she's a biggest supporter. She loves it. She says we're entrepreneurs, right?
We are.
We sure are.
She loves hearing the weird messages as well.
Yeah. Sometimes when we get the strangest requests, we sometimes think, have a look at this, and she gets quite a bit of a laugh or whatever out of it. But other members of the family, not so much. Would prefer that I didn't do it.
Yeah.
And I think in some aspects of their own personal relationships with their friends, if anything got brought up about Evelyn and I, they would just go, let's not talk about it.
Right.
So shy away.
You have two young children. Will you tell them about your work when they're a little bit older?
Yeah, absolutely. I think we're coming into a society now, like, it's getting a lot more accepted. The stigma behind it is dropping, it's reducing, which is great. But I also think in the 10 to 15 years that we are going to be bringing these conversations up with our now infant children, it's going to be so much more accepted. So, yeah,
really?
We don't have to worry about that too much. But
you get and I get is like, you're a bad mum.
Really?
Like, what would your kids think of this? Stuff like that. That's probably the number one.
And what do you say to that?
I just don't really reply to it, to be honest. Like, we have such a flexible life. We have so much to offer them now, thanks to OnlyFans. So I don't know if it's, better not to read it.
Thank you so much. Thank you to you all for being here. That's all we have time for this episode. Thank you too for joining us. You can catch up on this episode or any others on SBS On Demand. I'll see you next time.